about Russia. The protection is needed, regardless, in several regards, some of them unexpected. If one wants to speak in favor of Russia nowadays, you need the protection. If you want to speak against Russia, you also need the protection. And so we try to offer a space where the only criterion is intelligence and originality. And I think we've been doing a decent job at that. And we look forward to more. My colleagues came to me about a year ago and said, well, we should actually have a moment when the best scholarship is brought to the fore, when that scholarship is made accessible outside of the immediate field, and when and that scholarship is made accessible also to a larger educated public. I thought it was a very good idea. Unfortunately, only one name came to mind. And thank God he said yes, and that was Steve Kotkin. Steve Kotkin entered the scene of Russian studies, Soviet studies, history, in the late 1980s and early 1990s, also good timing because the Soviet Union was collapsing, and we understood that in different ways, and some of them not necessarily obvious, we needed to rethink how we were thinking. We had very good research, but we also had to think about where it was coming from and where it was going. Kotkin has chosen, in rapid succession, modest topics, and produced equally modest works. The first one was, if you look at the title, is Magnetic Mountain. The subtitle is really what you should look at, which was Stalinism as a Civilization, which was to rewrite the history of the Soviet Union, looking at one place, working in a fashion that's appropriate to him, given his training, working through the local and through the margins in order to arrive at the whole. The book was dedicated to MF. I think if there was one monograph that really changed the way we did the Soviet period, that was it. It's still read, and it still should be read. Right immediately after that, after writing about Stalinism, he wrote about his collapse, another modest project, which did the collapse of the Soviet Union. This book came out as Armageddon Averted. Again, on the surface, it was about why so few shots were fired in a major geopolitical shift and the collapse of the world order as we understood it. But it was also about something that he does in all of his work, which is to remind us that even specific events and even areas of constraint and limited opportunities, we're always dealing with spaces which are productive of new realities. And so he tried to show us how the late Soviet Union produced certain things, which then help explain how it was that the Soviet Union disintegrated. What happened next was the topic of his next book, again modest, which was a transition of all of socialism into whatever it is that we have today, post-socialist economies. Market reforms, I wouldn't say, but certainly property reforms, and shifts in the distribution of wealth and income. This was done in a book called Uncivil Societies. Once again, we're invited to consider that we should measure things less in terms of specific outcomes and more in terms of what was being produced more generally to give us the foundation to do our specific research. Uncivil Societies put forward the proposition that yes, a space that claimed to be outside of the state was being created, and it was what we had roughly called a society, but it wasn't necessarily civil. Most recently, Kotkin has been working on a large history of Siberia, but along the way he managed to consider another small topic, which was Stalin. If there is one figure that looms large in the 20th century imaginary, it is Stalin. Not many people have attempted it, because it's like trying to hold on to a lightning rod in a thunderstorm. It's simply too electric and too toxic for many people's tastes. If anyone can handle it, I think it would be Steve Kotkin. And he's going to speak to us today about the first volume of a three-volume history, in which he invites us, and again, consider what it is that Kotkin has done in his other works, which is to invite us to consider things not in terms of what is limited, what is concluded, but what is actually produced, and to restore to us a sense of excitement, really what scholarship is supposed to be about. Excitement, wonderment, the excitement of the discovery, the sense, in other words, that we're uncovering something new but making it accessible to us and bridging gaps over time and space. I think Kotkin's been very successful in the past, and I'm quite sure he'll be successful now. Without further ado, I give you Steve Kotkin.
Thank you for the invitation, and thank you for the introduction. I should say that the best I can hope for this year, if I get lucky, is to have written the second best book in Russian history. because Professor Katsonis's book, States of Obligation, is a fantastic, marvelous, unbelievable book, which will be out soon. I have to apologize that I don't have my own book. And that's because I was told this lecture had to happen in September. And the book won't be in stores till November, and I won't have a copy till 4 weeks from today. So all I've got is the bound, uncorrected page proofs. And so we'll continue to pass this around, although I was hoping to print from it during this lecture. The book in this version is about 630 pages of text, but the actual book is 730 pages of text. It's 300,000 words of text and 190,000 words of notes of bibliography. Volume 1, which goes up to 1928. This is the first time I've presented this book, and so I'm a little bit nervous. In addition to the fact that there's like a murderous row here, it's sort of like the Yankees lineup when they had Lou Gehrig and Babe Ruth. And they put them inches from my face, so I kind of don't know where to run. Let's see how this is going to work. Let me explain a little bit why you would do something like this. Why one would do something like this. And you know, just about everybody in this field at a certain stage of life thinks that they might write a Stalin book, and probably 50% of us do. So there's an occupational hazard that's built into this. My illustrious predecessor, as you know, at Princeton University did this a number of years ago. And managed two excellent volumes of his three projected. And so somehow it got into my head to do this also. And there were really two reasons. One was, and I'm going to explain a little bit of what I studied, one was the fact that it could be done. I wasn't sure that one could write a new significant analysis of Russian power in the world and Stalin's power in Russia. Because the documents of the police archive, the so-called KGB archive, are closed. The documents of the presidential archive are complicated. Some of them are available and some of them aren't. And I could go on. But Dmitry Volkogonov, who, as you know, most of you, was the head of the military archive in Moscow, he was able, with a research team, to gather documents from all the archives, not only the military archive, and he deposited them here in the United States when he was done. And there are 55 microfilms of documents of military and police archives, both at the Library of Congress and at the Hoover Institution at Stanford. And after I finished those 55 microfilms, I was persuaded that this could be possible. So I embarked on this a long time ago, first read through the Volkogonov stuff. Another reason that it looked possible was the wealth of publication of documents. Almost all the archives, including the KGB archive, have been publishing huge volumes of their own documents. And so you could read through the Foreign Policy Archive, the Military Archive, the KGB archive. Not everything, of course, what they selected, and not everything you would want even from what they selected, because sometimes it's excerpted. But it turned out to be multiple years of work to read through the published document collections. The ability to read the police and the military archives was very, very important because it was a police-military dictatorship. And so getting beyond the party archives was crucial, although the party archives, of course, are still necessary. In addition, the presidential archive began to declassify its material, and so the Stalin personal files at the party archive, so-called 558, began to acquire tremendous influx of documents from the so-called presidential archive. So 558, Opus 11, is all brand new, not previously available to researchers, starting in the early 2000s, and continued to fill in till about 3 years ago, material from the presidential archive. So what would that be? That would be things like doing a coup in another country in the early 1920s, for example. Anyway, so this outpouring of documentation meant that, in fact, it wasn't as efficient to go to the archive yourself, sit in the Foreign Policy Archive and read through the materials. It was much more efficient to read them at either the Hoover Institution or the New York Public Library because they were coming out in these multiple volumes. In addition, some people had access to things that were not coming out anywhere. Like, for example, this guy, Alexander Plekhanov, who was able to access the counterintelligence archive in Omsk, part of the KGB archive. The counterintelligence archive in Omsk is the richest archive of all the KGB materials. I, of course, went there in person, had all the documentation, tried to get myself in to be able to read the materials, and was not admitted to the archive. But then I made the acquaintance of Plekhanov, who teaches at the FSB Academy in Moscow, and he has a huge number of scans and other materials, plus he published numerous books using these materials where he quotes them. He published internal for FSB only picture books, like for example, a pictorial biography of Brzezinski, which includes the fact that he was consumptive early on and almost dead in the early 1920s. And there are some pictures in the book from the Plekhanov collection that he got out of the FSB archives. Anyway, so in other words, it's not like the old days where you went to Archive X and read through everything. Now there are scans and microfilms and contacts and published documents, and it's really a different type of research, and moreover, it's materials that we hadn't seen before, at least in significant quantity. So all of this told me that the book was viable as a research project. That, in other words, I could look at the most significant materials in large number. The other reason why I embarked on the project was because my agent told me it was also commercially viable. And so that combination really was irresistible. Andrew Wiley persuaded me to go for it. So where we are now is I wrote volumes 1 and 2, which go together up to 1941. I wrote them from the 1870s through 1941, taking each and then going to the middle, and turned them in, and volume 2 will be out probably. Volume 1 is out in November, as I said. Volume 2 will be out probably a year or 18 months after that, so now I have time to go back and make that even fatter. Volume 3 I haven't touched yet, which goes from the June 22nd, 1941 up through a little bit beyond his death. So that remains, that work remains to be done. Okay, so much for how this came about, and why I thought it was possible, and what I've been up to for this period of time. Now a little bit about what it says or doesn't say. So we have a number of challenges, obviously, with Stalin. One challenge is the fact that a lot of stuff in the public realm about him is a lie. This is very, very complicated. Turns out Beria is worse, but nonetheless, a lot of the stuff about Stalin is just not true. And when you go back and look at the original materials, you're quite shocked to see the difference between what the original materials might say and what we think we know. So this sifting process was very, very difficult. You try to be as scrupulous as possible, but nonetheless navigating that, because the regime is lying, and Stalin's enemies are blackening him. So that combination of each side lying about him produced the record that's very unreliable. I could give many, many examples of this. In addition, his early life is not very consequential. And the way people have gotten around this is they've either shortened the part before the revolution for almost nothing, or they invented a life before the revolution, which was worthy of the Man Booker Prize, although it didn't win. And that invention is based upon the fact that Beria, in the 1930s, got it in his head that he would flatter Stalin And the way he flattered Stalin was to gather everybody in the Caucasus who knew Stalin and to, quote, interview them. And then he had a functionary sit there and write the interviews out, and if they weren't vivid enough, the functionary took care of that. And Beria thought it was flattering that Stalin might be a mafia kingpin in the prison, for example, in Baku. Now, Stalin later would read this and say, are you kidding? No, it would all be suppressed, until Montefiore came along and found that material in Tbilisi. And that material is the Beria-produced Stalin fantastic Orientalist character, which already Esat Bey, Lev Nussbaum, had invented in the early 1930s, and then was recently repackaged, as I said, for us. So that's also a problem, because you certainly don't want to do that. So how do you deal with the early life if his early life is not that significant, and you don't want to invent a literary early life, however sexy that might be? And the answer I chose was to do the stuff besides Stalin that corresponded to his early life. So there's an entire chapter on Stolypin, for example. There's an entire chapter on Vita. And the thinking was that this is to enable people to understand who had their hands on the wheel of the Russian state before, and what Stalin would inherit, and how he would affect or not affect that. So the stuff that was bigger than him, at a certain point, is not going to be bigger than him, because he's going to be the one with the wheel on. But it was complicated, as my editor told me, it was complicated to keep Stalin in the picture when I'm arguing that Stolypin is very significant, what he's doing, and Stalin, the mafia kingpin of the Baku prison, is not that significant. The Baku prison had 8 windows. It was 8 windows long, and Stalin's was the second window. And even if he was the mafia kingpin of that prison, it was no bigger than this first row of NYU faculty, which I didn't know until I saw it in person, and then I saw some of the archival pictures of it. So this, by the way, is all I've got. It was an early, it was 2 years old already, it was an early projection of what the photographs in the book might look like. Penguin won't send me the electronic version of the photographs that are in the book. They paid for the electronic rights, and they're very cautious about this. So that's the observatory, by the way, where he worked. It was almost the only job he ever had, paid legitimate legal work in his art. Okay, so let's talk then a little bit about the content, now that I've set up what some of the challenges were to get into this. So the book makes a number of different arguments. This is the first one. The first one is that the unification of Germany by Bismarck and the Meiji Restoration are ruptures in world history. Both of them take place in the 1870s. Especially if you're a statesman in Russia, a brand new dynamic power on the continent, and a brand new, almost, but certainly newly dynamic power in East Asia, both of which are on your flanks, right, were transformative. There was no way to conduct Russian policy, internal or external, in the same way anymore, now that you were dealing with Germany and Japan on either side of you, Meiji Restoration Japan. Now, this happens to be the decade in which Stalin is born. Same decade, 1870. So this is the world in which he's born. And it's further complicated by the fact that the British Empire is the dominant power in the world, because as you know, the British and the French have fought a century-long war for to be the dominant power in the world, and the British unexpectedly have won by 1815, you know, when Napoleon is exiled, and the British are clearly the dominant power, there's no question, by any measurement whatsoever. Their state is smaller in terms of the number of functionaries, right, but their state is more efficient, and I go on with arguments like this. So you have a British-dominated world, the eruption of German power on the continent, the Meiji Restoration in Japan, and now all of a sudden what? In addition, right, there's other factors that relate to the geopolitics, the global political economy, but this is the founding argument of the book. And so Stalin is going to be born, not only born into this world, but buffeted by all of this, and then in turn he's going to affect this in a very, very big way. So there's an argument that state-to-state relations, geopolitics, are one of the primary motives of history. Second argument in the book you'll be familiar with this argument if you read my work, although you won't be familiar with it if you've read accounts of my work. That's a fair statement. And that is to say that modernity, modernization, is not a sociological process. It's a geopolitical process. Right? That means that certain attributes, mass production, an integrated mass politics polity, right? And I could go on. Certain attributes that we attribute to modernity are present in the great powers. And they force the other countries in the world to acquire those attributes or be colonized. And so modernity, modernization is a ruthless, unsentimental, geopolitical knives out process. It's not about going from traditional society to modern society. It's not about a change in values. It's about how much steel you can produce. Right? It's about how many people you can mobilize for your army. It's about how good your engineering schools or your officer corps might be. Right? This is modernity, and some countries have it, and they let you know. They show up at your door uninvited, and they start telling you they know how you're going to live now. They put their boot on your neck. And your choice here is either to do what they do and respond in kind, or to suffer under their boot. Russia is in this unsentimental, brutal, geopolitical race for modernity. And so you then have to have a fiscal military state. You have to be able to raise taxes. You have to be able to build ships. You have to have access to undersea cables or lay them yourself. And I could go on, right? Otherwise, it's going to be ugly. Because you cannot defeat modernity with nothing. You can only defeat modernity with modernity. And those countries that have it are continually, in dynamic fashion, raising the game, raising the stakes, doing better at various. So it's not just enough to catch up. It's constant, and the pressure is incredible. And if you know your world history, the period from the 1890s through World War I, right? Basically, 85% of the world is colonized by European great powers. And China is not colonized, but almost. And Russia is now going to have to respond to this world that they're in. So that's the big story. The story is not what prison you were in, what underground you were in, right? Because the underground revolutionary movement was destroyed by the Tsarist police for the most part. The only Bolshevik who was not in prison, right, just before the revolution, was Malinovsky, the Okhranka agent. The rest of them were in exile abroad, or in exile in Siberia, or in prisons. And so it's the modernity story. So the first one is that state-to-state relations, the eruption of German power and Japanese power. And then the second one is the modernity being hitched to this first argument. And the third argument is about how the Russian state successfully competes under these conditions. The Russian state is a success, not a failure. It manages to mobilize tremendous internal resources and to compete in this brutal, unsentimental international system as a great power. There's no question that that's the case, and the book tries to lay this out in detail. However, there's a problem with the Russian state. It has a fatal flaw, which is the Tsarist autocracy. The autocracy is dysfunctional. The Russian state is not pretty, but functional. But the autocracy is not. And they're unable to correct the autocracy, even though the state is able to compete. This is a story that sounds obvious, but as I read through the materials and tried to learn in depth how things function, for example, details like the Duma. The Duma had no procedure for cutting off debate. The Duma had no procedure for limiting the number of people on a subcommittee. And so the Duma was dysfunctional because of its proceduralism. Its procedures were no good. I didn't know that type of history. So you delve into this detail, and you begin to get the picture of the Tsarist state, which can mobilize resources, but the autocracy doesn't seem to be fixable. and they end up, as you know, in the war, and the whole world crashes. Now, the only way for a nobody from the periphery of an empire to get anywhere near the seat of power is if the whole world comes crashing down. So Stalin does nothing during World War I. He's in Siberia on the Mosquito and Boredom Front. That's his World War I. He publishes nothing. He writes quite a lot. Trotsky is a liar in this regard. Stalin writes a lot, but he doesn't publish it. And anyway, so he's going to come to power by things which are nothing he did himself and nothing that the Bolshevik regime did, but a lot that the international system did and that the Tsar's autocracy did. So this will get you, this you're only a third of the way into the book now, right? World War I story. And this is going to get you the revolution. We tell the revolution story. And eventually, there's a chapter on 1918 alone, because 1917 is just not the big story compared to 1918. And in 1918, you're stateless. The chapter on 1918 is called Dada, and there's a Dada-esque quality to the, quote, regime in 1918. There is no real regime in 1918. They haven't built a state yet. And so they don't have policies, because they don't actually govern anything. They don't really have money. They've destroyed the financial system on purpose, etc. They're going to create a state, and we go through that story of how they come out of the Dada-esque 1918. And there's a chapter called Voyages of Discovery, which is sort of like the Vasco da Gama Columbus Voyages of Discovery, but it's about the Eurasian landings. Anyway, that was preamble to get you now to Stalin's regime. So Stalin's regime is not foreseeable, there's no way. His power is not foreseeable, absolutely not. But nonetheless, it comes into being through these various different combinations, right? And history is about people who seize opportunities that they didn't create. Right? This is what von Moltke said strategy was about. Opportunities arise, combinations arise, things happen that you didn't create, but you seize them for your own advantage. Right? This is history. There's accident, there's perverse outcomes, there's perverse consequences, but significant figures in history are those who seize the opportunities and move them in some direction that benefits themselves. They get to ride history as well. Okay. So now I'm going to give you some of the meat of the story that was maybe a little bit too much said. So you know the story about how Stalin is appointed General Secretary, right, in April 1922, General Secretary of the Party. We have very good documentation on this. I've now read all those original documents, including the ones in Lenin's hand, and there's no question that he was appointed General Secretary on purpose in a conspiracy partly against Trotsky, because that's what Lenin spent a lot of time doing, conspiring against Trotsky, whom he disliked more than he disliked Stalin. And there's no question that Stalin was chosen because of qualities that he had, and there's no question that the job was assumed to be a really big job. April 1922, in May 1922, Lenin has his first stroke. Stalin is appointed General Secretary in April 1922, and May 1922, as you know, Lenin has his first stroke. So he's a dictator already in May 1922. He didn't cause Lenin's first stroke, but of course he seized that opportunity. He has an office in 1922 on Vozdvizhenka. He's not on Old Square yet, let alone in the Kremlin. Vozdvizhenka number 3 and then Vozdvizhenka number 5. This is where the Oprichnina was located. Of course, that building is long gone, but on Vozdvizhenka, which derives its name from a monastery that burned down during the Napoleonic times. Anyway, so he's in this building, and he now, all of a sudden, is the one who's the liaison to the police. And the first documentation we have of Stalin with the police, with the GPU, are letters back and forth with Yagoda from 1922, immediately upon becoming General Secretary. He's already setting up agents inside the secret police on his own behalf. Now, there's a person in charge of the secret police, Dzerzhinsky. There's a second person in the secret police, Medzhinsky, both of them Poles, ethnic Poles, although the second one was crucified. And then there's this character Yagoda, or Gena, as they called him. And he's basically a wheeler and dealer commerçant. He's not a significant police figure. And Stalin latches onto him and begins to run a small conspiracy inside the secret police already from May 1922. Because there's only one part of the apparatus that is permitted to carry on correspondence, secret correspondence with the police, liaise with the police, and that's the party, inter-party bureaucracy. The same thing happens on the military side. Right? Trotsky is, of course, Commissar of War, and he's head of, he's the chairman of the military, Revolutionary Military Council of the Republic, but Stalin begins to cultivate agents inside the police in a similar fashion, and to exert control over the military, exert control over the military through the party apparatus. Very energetically building the party apparatus, but vis-a-vis the police and the military. They have meetings, they have Politburo meetings, they have discussions, they write out documents about what the decisions are, what the vote was, that goes into the party archive. Then he goes back to his office, implements the decisions, if he feels like it, not implement the decisions if he doesn't feel like it. The check on his implementation is himself, right? It's his party apparatus that's supposed to check whether the decisions are being implemented or not. So you can go through and see that he doesn't do things that were agreed to and that he himself voted for at the meeting that are reflected in the party archives. Instead, he did it another way. And you can see him doing things which are not necessarily discussed at the meetings until post facto. He'll call in Josef Unschlicht, who is a police military operative, and they'll decide to have a coup in Estonia. And Unschlicht will begin to gather a bunch of paramilitaries and infiltrate them into independent Estonia and send the various different messengers back and forth, get ready, it's going to be this day. Oh no, get ready, it's going to be that day. Right? So he has this guy, Unschlicht, who's a fantastic figure, very adept, and he has a personal relationship with him, and there's some documentation about this plotting of the Estonian coup, but it takes place also informally inside this regime that Stalin's dictatorship, we're talking about the period 1922 to 24. So there's a chapter called Dictator, which goes in detail about this. And it has the geography of the regime. Where was everybody located? This is Old Square. It's a former merchant building. This is the Commissariat of Foreign Affairs. Right? And the next one should be, this is Namka 23, which is the military, where Trotsky had his office. It's the old Alexander Uchilishev or military school in Moscow. And you can see, this is Stalin with military figures. This is Unschlicht, right? Trotsky is in this picture, but he was cut out. The newsreel shows Trotsky. It's the only piece of history we have where Trotsky and Stalin are in the same picture. It's in the newsreel, but the photograph published in the newspaper obviously didn't happen. Anyway, so then Stalin begins to do this stuff, run the dictatorship from the inside, and eventually in January 1924, he moves to Old Square. January 1924 happens also to be when Lenin dies. January 24, he's in Old Square. And in January 1928, he's going to go to Siberia and just tell everybody he's going to collectivize agriculture. That's how abrupt all of this is. So now he's working Yagoda inside the police, but it's not enough. Because who's going to watch Yagoda? So Stalin cultivates this guy named Artur Frauchi. Frauchi's father is a Swiss cheesemaker who's come to Russia, set up a Swiss cheese business, and the son, Artur Frauchi, goes to all the right schools, and he ends up being head of Soviet counterintelligence when it's founded. And unlike Yagoda, he's a real police operative. Artuzov is the last name he takes. Artur Artuzov, even though his name is the Swiss-Italian Frauchi. And so Stalin begins to pit the Artuzov, the Frauchi Artuzov crowd, who's counterintelligence, against Yagoda. And so everywhere he's finding not only his agent, but the enemy of his agent. He's setting up these sometimes natural, sometimes artificially created by him, relationships of enmity that he can then draw upon. Right, this is all 1922 to 24. This is all available in the newly released, published archival documents out of these the counterintelligence archives, police archives, military archives. Okay. So we get the story, right? But then there's another piece to this exact same period. And that is that there's an alleged dictation by Lenin. There's an alleged dictation by Lenin to remove Stalin. So I'm thinking, let's go read that dictation. I want to see that dictation. And you get into the party archive, and it doesn't. There's no paper. The dictation doesn't exist. There is no such shorthand document. And I said, this can't be. You guys are teasing me, right? I mean, I read it in the complete Lenin works, the PSS, Polnaya Sobraniya Sochinenia. It's in there. It's got to be here. And it's not there. There is no actual Lenin testament. This is a puzzling and important discovery, which was made by Valentin Safarov, who is a Stalinist historian at Moscow University. What's there are a few typescripts which have things added to them at later dates that don't have the initials of Lenin on them and whose content has changed over time. And so it's a little bit suspicious. Moreover, there are all these stories about the Lenin Testament, about how, for example, he dictated it, but it was only to be released to the Party Congress after his death. It was a supposedly letter to the Congress. But the letter to the Congress stuff was added later to the document. Moreover, the document wasn't released after Lenin died. It was released immediately after the first Party Congress that Lenin didn't attend in May 1923. Krupskaya showed this typescript to Zinoviev. Remember, Zinoviev had been in Zurich with Lenin, and Zinoviev's wife and Krupskaya were very, very close. Zinoviev and Lenin were not quite as close, but still closer than most Bolsheviks to Lenin at this time. So she showed it to Zinoviev after Trotsky's defeat at the Party Congress, the 12th Party Congress, the first one that Lenin is not attending. And it's clearly a document inserted to balance Stalin's power. Did Lenin dictate the document? It's impossible to say. Therefore, you cannot take it. Unless more evidence comes forward, you can't take it as a genuine document, the typescript. There are many shorthand documents of Lenin's dictation that were recorded by the stenographer. We have those, and they're messy. We don't have anything for this one. Moreover, after this thing didn't work, the version of Lenin's testament that's famous or infamous, Krupskaya brought out another document the next month in June 1923. And the second document is the one that says remove Stalin. But she didn't give them both at the same time. She gave one to Zinoviev in May 23, and she showed the second one to Zinoviev in June 23. Zinoviev and Bukharin went on vacation to Kislevodsk. Kislevodsk, right? Kislevodsk, the spa town. And they conspiratorially, which is an infamous story, met in a cave. And they had a very small number of people there. Lashevich was there, Varashila. Frunze didn't make it, or Zhonikidze didn't make it, etc. And they have this little conspiratorial discussion in the cave what to do. And Zinoviev writes a letter to Stalin. Actually, Bukharin wrote the letter, but then signed, Zinoviev's name is signed on it, talking to Stalin about how there's this letter from Lenin about the general secretary position. And Stalin is supposed to know all of this from the spies, but this is the first time he finds out about it, and he's shocked. What do you mean there's a letter from Lenin about the general secretary? He's back in Moscow. He's doing the planning for the coup in Germany. He's running the whole show, and they're all on vacation in Kislevodsk, in Kislevodsk. And now they're telling him that there's a document talking about his removal. So he blows up,
and says, you better come back, and they come back to Moscow to discuss this, and there's no copy of this document in any of Stalin's paperwork. There are copies in Stalin's paperwork of so many documents that he saved, which have his blue pencil mark or his checks on them, and there's no document of anything Lenin testament in any of Stalin's paperwork. Either he wasn't shown this document, he wasn't given the document, he was only shown it at this point. It's hard to say. But nonetheless, it's a surprise to him, in the middle of the struggle with Trotsky, Krupskaya is trying to balance his power. So here you have a story of a guy who's already a dictator, because in April 1922, he becomes general secretary. And he begins to act upon, he seizes that opportunity. And in May 22, Lenin has the first stroke. But almost in that same period of 22, 24, in parallel, there's this thing from Lenin talking about Stalin's removal that seems very suspicious. And so he begins to behave in very weird ways in relationship to this alleged Lenin document. He begins to resign. He resigns at least six times, orally or in writing, over the next several years. Just about every significant party gathering, he resigns. And says, you know, that's when maybe Lenin was right, okay? You don't want me around? Fine, I'll resign. And then, of course, as we know, Alexei Rykov stands up. Rykov is the chairman of the government, the prime minister, and so he chairs the Politburo meetings. So it always falls to Rykov to get up and say, of course we can't accept your resignation, Comrade Stalin. And then they have a vote, and the vote is almost unanimous not to accept his resignation, except one person votes against not accepting his resignation. Stalin himself. So here you have the complicated psychology. Here it is. Inherits the dictator position, and begins to create a personal dictatorship inside. Just because you inherit this possibility doesn't mean you succeed, right? For example, if I were to inherit such a position, I might fumble it. I might not know how to manipulate the police and manipulate the army and make sure I control all the ciphers for the diplomatic work. I might not know how to get the dirt on Chechen and the dirt on everybody else that I'm accumulating. He knows how to do this. He's very good at this. But at the same time, he begins to enter the psychological tunnel of the so-called testament, for which the original document doesn't exist, but it exists big time in all the party discussions. And the Trotskyites begin to circulate this. And they put on the top of the document Lenin's testament for the first time. Zavishanya Lenina. And they circulate it. And then they call a party control commission meeting. And Dzerzhinsky's presiding, and he says, you know, you're not allowed to circulate this. And meanwhile, Stalin is exercising unchecked power for the most part. His power is limited by the fact that the country is very large, that the place is totally corrupt, that communications are primitive, right? There are all sorts of limitations on his power. There just aren't any significant constitutional limitations on his power. On executive authority. Anyway, so this is the Stalin that emerges in the 1920s and that emerges in my book. And it goes on like this. The coups that he's doing with Unschlicht and with others, the correspondence he's conducting with Yagoda and others, he's accumulating a big file on Yagoda because Yagoda is using foreign currency to purchase rare goods abroad in Europe for the elite, which Stalin is allowing that to happen and then having somebody record all of that to show it to Yagoda and then to threaten him. Right? So he's doing all of this at the same time as the threat over him is huge because of this alleged testament. And of course it's discussed at every single party meeting and it keeps coming out and every time, right, somebody's supposed to get expelled, Zinoviev will stand up and say, you can expel me, but I'm going to read from Lenin's testament. And then he reads it out loud. And then the shouting of the Stalinists to shout him down that it can't be heard. And then Stalin will get up and he himself will read from the testament. And he'll twist it. He'll emphasize those things which are anti-Trotsky or anti-Zinoviev. and he'll play down those things that are anti-Stalin. So this is inner party life in the 20s. It's this Lenin Testament thing, which we don't know where it came from ultimately. It could be that Krupskaya herself interpreted Lenin's inability to speak and paralysis. It could be that the stenographer, Volodicheva, or the head of the secretariat, Futieva, was involved in this. We don't know any of that. Because Lenin, the most secret documents about Lenin's illness are still still classified. We have the doctor's memoirs, we have a lot of stuff, but the inner core of Lenin's illness stuff is not there for researchers to use. It's very hard to tell this. We don't know if Stalin believed or didn't believe that the testament was fake. We have Yanukitza at a party meeting speaking about how this is really curious. We have Volkogonov writing that he's perplexed how Lenin, who was paralyzed and virtually speechless, which we know from the doctor's memoirs, was somehow able to dictate all of this. That is to say, Volkogonov understood the paradox that's involved. So here we go. We now have an explanation, potentially, for Stalin's warped psychology, for his demonic mind, which is not rooted in the fact that his father beat him, which is not well documented. There's only one memoir that substantiates this. There are other memoirs that contradict that he was beaten as a child. There are some that say his mother beat him more than his father. There are some that say the mother beat the father. I don't know how reliable any of this is, but the fact that Stalin was beaten as a child is no longer necessary for us. Whether it's true or not, I don't think it's true. Moreover, we don't have to deal with the seminary story about how the snitching and the authoritarianism, right, and the terrible priests at the seminary deformed his character, because of course that seminary produced huge numbers of people and very few of them were psychopathic murderers. So the seminary is not necessary anymore, but this dynamic of having unlimited power as a dictator, and at the same time, this piece of paper allegedly attributed to Lenin calling for your removal. This was Stalin's inner life. This is where I believe, it's impossible to prove, it's a hypothesis, based partly on Sakharov's work, Valentin Sakharov, that this is where the Stalin psychology primarily comes in. Moreover, you have a structural phenomenon that I add to this, which is the fact that the revolution, right, has created capitalist encirclement. Right, Bolshevism creates capitalist encirclement on October 25th, 1917, with the coup, with the seizure of power, with the claim of power, and now they are encircled by the capitalist powers. And the capitalist powers, unfortunately, are not serious about stamping out Bolshevism, but nonetheless, they do things in that direction on occasion. And so there's this mentality, there's this struggle, there's this capitalist encirclement dynamic. And Stalin's personal situation inside the regime is paralleling the regime, the country's relationship to the outside world, and they're mutually reinforcing. Right? He's encircled by enemies with this Lenin Testament, and the country is encircled by enemies. And back and forth it goes. And eventually there's going to be terrorism. A few of the emigre associations are going to blow up a GPU dormitory, a secret police dormitory, right? And of course, as a result of which, Stalin is going to say terrorism is rampant, and he's going to start equating the opposition to terrorism. This is all happening already in 1926-27. So in 26-27, you begin to see the kind of regime and the kind of Stalin related to the structural phenomenon of him being, as it were, under the testament and the country being encircled by the capitalists. It's much more complicated than that, and the details were surprising to me, but that's the basic outline. All right, I'll go a little bit more. Can I go a little bit more before questions? Yeah, I've never given this talk before, right? And the book is 750 pages of text. So I have no idea what to say and what not to say from the book. I'm flubbing this. Maybe the next time it'll be a little bit better. You don't know. But this time it's a flub, but nonetheless you're getting at least something of what's in the book. And I hope now that we'll, shall we pause for a minute so that everybody could pre-order with their phone? No?
Give us some more.
You're not ready to pre-order yet? You know what? I'm with you on that. I agree with you on that. So the book is analytical narrative. It's deep narrative. It's detail after detail after detail. You get inside, you get to feel the life of the regime. Because the regime is a society. This is what people don't understand. They think society means outside the state. They think society means those people who live in the countryside, the peasantry, the intelligentsia. For some reason, that's society. But the gangster regime is a society. They mix with each other. They have shared value systems. They have bases of solidarity. And so this is actually a story about power, but in terms of the regime being a society. It's very important. Of course, Stalin is at the center of the society, but he's not the only figure. As you get into volume two, the regime society is very much smaller, and it's just his office in the Kremlin. But in volume one, there's an expansive regime society, and there's a recruitment process of people that he's conducting. And he finds people. He'll go through these dossiers of provincial leaders, and he'll find good ones. He finds Ulanov out of Nizhny Novgorod, and everybody says, oh, Ulanov was a Zinoviev protege, Ulanov was a Bukharin figure. But in fact, there's a document with Stalin's markings on it of characterizing an evaluation of Ulanov's work from Nizhny Novgorod, and Stalin has decided to promote him at this point. And then when Ulanov is inside Moscow, no longer working on the Zinoviev in Petrograd, Zinoviev approaches Ulanov to join the opposition, and Ulanov laughs him off. Right? This is all stuff we now know, and it's all about the regime society. And it rearranges who's who and what's what and how the patronage networks work. But anyway, this wouldn't be that interesting. I agree with you on that. But the regime is beginning to close off its options. The regime is beginning to wound itself. It's mismanaging the quasi-market net economy. Remember, there's no net economy in industry, right? Industry doesn't have a net. Industry is state-owned. There are trusts. And almost all privateers are squeezed out of the picture already by 1927. Less than 10% of industrial production is non-state by 27 already. And the state is not a market system. If you're bankrupt, you get more money from the state. If you're doing well with profit, you get less money from the state. The perverse incentives are in operation in the 20s in the industrial economy. The peasantry is being mismanaged because they're worried that there are kulaks out there. And it's a big problem. They continually have this debate. Not are there kulaks out there, but where do we cut off the kulak number? In other words, if I have 3 cows this year and 6 cows next year, have I become a kulak? All the documents, right, are saturated with this conversation. Especially the local documents that are being sent to Moscow with this question. And the local agents are interpreting the kulak question as they see fit. Meaning that they're marrying their daughters to the kulak because the kulak's house is bigger. And they're getting loans, forgivable loans. And my faculty will understand this. They're getting forgivable loans from the kulak. But at the same time, they're submitting names of kulaks who have 3 to 6 cows because they got to fulfill the number of the kulak quota in reporting. Right, so all of this is going on at the same time. There's been a peasant revolution. There's a market economy in the village that the regime can't regulate and can't really control. And then there's going to be a collision between this. The regime more and more can't figure out how to do the economy already before 1929. So this is all happening with the international situation, which we have to figure in, with global political economy, right? There's a global price for grain, and it's going down. Global price for all commodities go down, because it's not great to be a commodity producer.
It's much better to be higher up the value chain in the brutal, unsentimental international system. And the regime is not high up on the value chain. And the Red Army on the holidays crossing Red Square on bicycles, because they don't have any tanks. The Red Army doesn't really have tanks. And the reports from Voroshilov about the fact that if we actually had to fight a war, I don't know what we would do, because we don't have any military industry to produce any of the stuff that would be required. And so here's this regime, Stalin on Old Square, Kaganovich is in Ukraine for a while, but also on Old Square, Molotov's on Old Square, and they walk down Ilinka, which connects Old Square to Red Square, after work, heading for their apartment in the Kremlin, and Voroshilov is walking down Znamenka, or taking the car down Znamenka, in his case, 23, to get into the Kremlin. They get inside the Kremlin, and they're not at a Politburo meeting. They meet in Voroshilov's apartment, because Stalin's apartment is in the amusement palace, the Potiachny Dvor, second floor of the Potiachny Dvor. This is Stalin's apartment, right here. That's the view of the Kutafya Tower. It's the only boyar residence in the whole Kremlin, and it was the Kremlin commandant's residence. Trotsky was in the cavalry building. Lenin was originally in the cavalry building. Lenin moved into the Imperial Senate, the third floor, as you know, and Trotsky stayed in the cavalry building. And Stalin is in the Potiachny Dvor, the amusement palace. Voroshilov is in the Grand Kremlin Palace. He's got the biggest and best apartment. Demian Vietny, the poet, Grigorov lives on the same hallway as Voroshilov. Yusis, Ivan Yusis, the Lithuanian bodyguard, who cooks the bear meat on the spit at the Matsesta Sochi Dacha that Stalin goes gaga for. The Lithuanian cooked bear meat. Yusis lives in an anteroom type apartment inside the Grand Kremlin. So this is the regime, these Kremlin apartment regimes. Rykov lives in the Potiachny Dvor, in the amusement palace, the boyar residence, with Stalin, but they don't socialize, even though Rykov is by far the second most powerful person inside the regime, because he has Lenin's position running the government. So they go to Voroshilov's apartment. Usually, sometimes they go to Stalin's apartment, but that's very rare. They go to Voroshilov's apartment and they start to chew the fat. We don't have any tanks. What are we going to do? Right? The peasants, they won't send the grain, because the prices are too low, or there are no manufacturers, because industry's been mismanaged, right? And on they go with this conversation every night for a couple of years on end. And they're waiting for him to figure this out, because he's primus inter pares, right? He's the head of the retinue. He's the head of this merry band of mediocrities. And he doesn't know what to do. And they go back and forth, then they have these meetings, and of course, Nikolai Bukharin, strong intellectual figure, right, making some arguments in public, because he's the editor of the newspaper and a very prominent public voice. Right, there's that going on at the same time, applying pressure here and there. There's the Zinoviev Trotsky Kamenev stuff, which Sokolnikov joins for a while. That is to say, Girsch Brilliant, who is the smartest Bolshevik inside the regime, and is the one who's done the net. He's done the new economic policy. He did it already in Turkestan before he came to Moscow. Here's Brilliant, the monetary reform. He creates the chervonets, right? So that all sorts of this is going on, but they're meeting in the merry band. It's only a handful of people meeting and stuff in Voroshilov's apartment. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? At the 15th Party Congress in December 1927, Stalin resigns again. That is, he writes out his resignation, and Rykov has to stand up and repudiate Stalin's resignation. This is unbelievable, December 1927. All Rykov had to do was say, okay, we'll take it. Your resignation is effective today. All those in favor, and the room would have got hushed. Who knows what would have happened? But instead, Rykov once again overcomes Stalin's resignation. And then they have no grain, as you know, because they've had a big bender here, right? They had the 10th year anniversary in November 7th, 1927, and now they have this big party congress, right?
which lasts from, what, December 2nd, December 3rd to December 19th, something like that, I forget. I don't have the volume in front of me right now. And so they're on this huge bender, they're not paying attention, there's no grade, and so Stalin goes back to his office, he sends out these threatening circulars. I want this grain, I want this much, and I want it now, and no grain is being collected. And so he decides to send the plenipotentiaries out. Lenin has done this too. Lenin sent Dzerzhinsky to Siberia to collect the grain. It's when Dzerzhinsky first figured out that the revolution was a bust. He then was self-confused about this, but there are great letters from him on the Siberian trip back to his wife, Zofia Mushka. Romania and Hungary work together for war. They assassinate the Soviet ambassador to Warsaw on the platform of the train station, and on it goes. And you can say that these reports are not true, they don't reflect the reality of the situation, but of course this is what Stalin is receiving and what he's spending his time reading. True or not, in some objective sense, they are the worldview of Soviet military intelligence. So here we go. So then he decides in early January to send out the plenipotentiaries. Molotov's going to go here, Andreev is going to go there, right? Go get the grain. Go get the grain. He sends Orjonikidze to Siberia. Now Orjonikidze is not a healthy person. Grigol Sergo Orjonikidze. He only has one kidney. He's only got one kidney. And he's got other ailments besides the fact that he's only... So he's constantly out of action. So he, you know, says, I can't do it. So Stalin says, okay, I'll go to Siberia. I'm going to go for Orjonikidze instead. So Stalin calls in a bunch of officials to Old Square. They have a meeting, and then, of course, they set up this military entourage that's going to take him out to Siberia. He gets on the train. He leaves Moscow January 15th, 1928. He's already sent a bunch of functionaries out there to prepare the trip, and he's demanded a whole bunch of materials to read on the train. So this armed train, armed to the teeth, with Stalin and functionaries, three quarters of it, of course, the secret police, they're going out to Siberia. So you can imagine you're in Siberia, you're Sergei Sirtsov, you used to work in Stalin's secretariat, he made you the party boss of Siberia in 1926, you're a kid, and you get a telegram, I'm coming to Siberia. And so Sirtsov goes wild. What's he going to do? He's got to go out to every place that Stalin could possibly show up at and get it painted, right? And get the loudmouths locked up and get the officials sober somehow, right? Seriously, we have documentation on this process. He's got basically 2 to 3 days before Stalin's going to show up. He starts passing decrees about, you know, taking kulaks down and using these laws against anti-speculation to use them against the kulak, and he's going to present them to Stalin as a present when Stalin shows up at the train station. So it's an unbelievable big event. The newspapers do not mention that Stalin is going to Siberia. It's a secret, but the internal regime knows, and Sergei Sirtsov certainly knows. Okay, this is the Congress. Stalin walking out, few days later, Zinoviev is going to get the so-called Lenin Testament. It's a happy-go-lucky look, and then boom, Lenin Testament. This is the death mask of Lenin that's going to show up in Stalin's office. That, as I said, is Old Square. Stalin's up on the top floor. You need a pass to get into Old Square, and you need a pass for Stalin's office suite. And so most of your Politburo members cannot walk into Old Square and see Stalin in Old Square unless their minions have called in advance to have a pass ready for them. There's Bukharin, Abel Yurnikidze, that's Rykov, there's Voroshilov. Right? Menzhinsky was hit by a car in France and was immobilized, and that's why he received people lying down, and he only spent 3 to 4 hours a day at work. This is Guy Farucci, Artuza, the son of the Swiss cheesemaker, who's Stalin's guy against Yagoda, right? Miss Kirov, who was a bit of a mediocrity as an organizer, but very, very good as a public speaker. These are the Three Musketeers retouched photograph. If you've seen the bound galleys, the photograph is unretouched.
Stalin photograph on the book is the army touch. It's the only army touch that's Piłsudski. Stalin obsessing about Piłsudski and all his military intelligence reports. This is a Chinese intriguing against Chiang Kai-shek. These are the military attachés of all the enemies on Red Square in 1928. This is just around the time of the Party Congress in December 1927. This is Yaroslavsky, Gumelman, right? This is Petrovsky, Dniepropetrovsk, which is named after him, the Ukrainian Congress. This is Siberia. That's Stalin and Sentsov. It's the only picture of Stalin in Siberia. This is the guy who found out, you know, a couple of days before that Stalin was showing up. Those are the fabricated Shakti documents. We can now read the process of fabrication. That's the verdict that Shakti being read. Anyway, so Stalin's going out to Siberia, and he's going to apply coercion to get the grain. And he gives a big speech to all the party elite in Novosibirsk about how we got to apply coercion to get the grant. And somebody at the meeting stands up, Sergei Zagumyonny, who's the head of the Agricultural Credit Union or what, Credit Bank. Zagumyonny, he's maybe 30, 31, 32 years old, I forget exactly. And he says, this is not going to work. If you apply coercion to get grain, you'll get a little bit at the beginning, but then you'll get less later. You'll end up with less grain overall. So here's Stalin laying down the law, and this kid is disputing him, and moreover, he says, and I know because my father still lives in the village, and I know the village better than you. But Stalin brushes this guy off. I mean, there's this gigantic police entourage. These meetings take place in police facilities, especially in Krasnoyarsk at 3 in the morning when he shows up there. It's a, the party comes to meet with Stalin in the GPU building. But anyway, so this guy's Zagumyonny on the 18th when they have this meeting, January 18th, 1928, disputing Stalin, whatever. They must have brushed over at the meeting because they passed all the resolutions that Stalin wanted and Sertsov had the thing under control, it looked like. Zagumyonny decides to write out his ideas the next day and hand Stalin a memo, a multi-page memo about how this is not going to work. And Stalin reads the memo, and he's got the blue pencil, ha ha, underlining, exclamation points, and he calls another meeting. He calls another meeting the next day, January 20th, in an hour circle, and he gives a speech announcing that we're going to collectivize agriculture. He's not told anybody yet. It hasn't been in the resolutions of the Party Congress. There's a kind of ambiguous resolution of the Party Congress that this might be a good idea. 1% of the arable land is collectivized at this point, and most collective farms are no bigger than 17 households, and the majority of them average 11 to 13 households. So there's no collectivization, it's not happening voluntarily. And he gets up and makes this speech and he says, you know, why is the kulak strong? Because the kulak has scale, and with scale you get machinery. Can we do it like America? Or like these other latifundia countries and have these big kulak farms? No, we're a socialist country. We need to get to scale. We need to have mechanization. But it can't be with kulaks. We're going to collectivize. And obviously the people are a little bit shocked about this because collectivization has always meant that poor peasants who couldn't manage farms as individual households joined up in these tiny 11, 13, 15 household collective farms, and they gave them a little bit of extra stuff so that they wouldn't stop. That's what collectivization has meant, voluntary collectives, before Stalin has shown up. So on January 20th, 1928, Stalin gives this big peroration in a hall this size that he's going to collectivize it. There's no newspaper coverage. He's made this speech. Then he goes on, he goes to Barnaul, and in Barnaul there are no cars, there are no vehicles. There are only 5,500 vehicles in the whole country, and there are none in Barnaul. So he shows up on this armored train, gets there at Barnaul, and they have a horse, a white horse named Marat from the French Revolution, and they have a wooden basket called a kashovka attached to the horse, and Stalin gets in it, and they throw down that big black coat with the square shoulders that Baron Wrangel used to wear for his photographs. Not actually on the battlefield, but his photographs. They throw it out of the cell, and they pull him. Marat, the horse, and the guy, the driver of the horse, is going to be the principal executioner for the Siberian NKVD and the terror, but he doesn't know that yet. And they pull Stalin to this meeting, and he gets up there at Barnaul, and they want to have a banquet. You know, the czars come, they want to get drunk, they want to do this, they want to. He says, you know, I just read all your newspapers. That's what I did on the train getting here all the way from Moscow. I read all the internal reports about the kulaks and this and that, and you're not doing the job. There's no class approach here. There's no class approach, and there better be a class approach or else. And he makes the speech, and once again, they're all shocked. What's this about? Because they're living well. They're reporting the number of kulaks. As I said, they're marrying their daughters to the kulak at the same time, right? So the game, they understand the game, and they're doing well with the game, but he's changing the rules of the game. Sertsov leaves Stalin in Omsk, and then goes back to Novosibirsk, and they're all like, is he right? Are we going to collectivize now? And Sertsov's like, I don't know yet, just be cool. We're not sure if this is going to happen yet. And Stalin goes out to Krasnoyarsk, and he's got this guy, Roberts Aika, in tow, who's the Latvian government minister out there in Siberia. He makes a similar speech. He's sending telegrams back to Kasyor at the secretariat about stuff that's going on. So all of this is well documented, has been well documented for 20-something years. We have the Siberian archive side, and we have 558 Opus 11 that came out of the presidential archive on this. So there's not many disputes on this. So he's decided to do it. Now, this is not the important part of history. It's never important when you decide to do something like this. It's the fact that the whole country goes up in flames and revolts, and you keep doing it. Right? It's the persistence. History is made by those people who don't give up. And so he's constantly under pressure when he gets back to Moscow to undo the coercive measures. And he has these tactical retreats at the meeting where he'll say, oh yeah, you're right, let's repeal the tactical, the coercion. And then he goes out and provokes incidents that require more coercion. And then he says, you see, I told you, we might have to keep the coercion. And so all through 28, he's playing a cat and mouse game about whether he's going to make this coercion temporary or permanent. But it's clear from the internal documentation that he's made this decision and that he's going to collectivize the country. The mystery, of course, and the mystery of the book is, where does that power come from? How do you rearrange the socioeconomic base, right, of an entire country this big, of all Eurasia? Where do you get the kind of power to do this? The Siberian party can't do this. A, they don't want to do it, and B, they're drunk. We have the Stubis, the Latvian KGB, GPU chief, whose name is Lenin Zakovsky in Russified form. He's sending back all these reports about how everything is drunk. He's getting these things from Yagoda. They can't be drunk when Stalin gets there, etc. He doesn't have the capacity in the countryside to do this. But he's brought a whole bunch of young, I have to say the audience reminds me of some of these people, young firebrands who are going to do what's necessary to create the new world. And they go out and begin to work the collectivization and report back already during Stalin's trip that, yeah, we can find the grain. And yeah, we can get rid of these kulaks and put them on trial or shoot them or whatever. But that's small. That's still small. He doesn't quite have enough. So he goes back home. He's fighting this battle. He's fake retreats or tactical retreats, pressuring, provoking, trying to make this happen, but he doesn't have those levers of power yet. It's a way in which collectivization is going to create the levers of power that make collectivization possible. It's a real chicken and egg conundrum. But he's got a secret weapon. He's got a secret weapon. He's got this guy, Yefim Yevdokimov is a not well-educated, but spectacularly shrewd police operative. And he's been in the North Caucasus. And Yefim Yevdokimov in the North Caucasus has done the counterinsurgency, because there's an insurgency in the North Caucasus the whole time during the 20s. And so there's never been normal time in the North Caucasus. There's always been troikas, or boards of three people, passing execution sentences without evidence or without trial, right? So-called troikas. This has gone on for the entire 1920s. And moreover, Stalin vacations, as you know,
on a cliff between Sochi and Matsesta in the Puzanovka dacha. That becomes his southern dacha. There's a story that we know from Mikoyan about how this was started. Part of that is true. In any case, he's going to Puzanovka, and guess who is in charge of Stalin's security when he goes south? Yefim Yevdokimov. So Yevdokimov shows up in Puzanovka dacha between Sochi and Matsesta, and he says to him, "You know what? I got industrial sabotage in the coal regions. You're not going to believe this. I got all of these specialists from the Tsarist era causing accidents on purpose, breakdowns in the coal region." Stalin's like, "Tell me more." And so then at the end of the discussion, and Stalin says to him, "You know, just send it to me directly." Actually, he says, "Send it to the Central Committee directly." This is meaning the apparatus on Old Square. "Don't send it through regular channels," meaning not through the Menzhinsky by now is in charge, because Dzerzhinsky has died. He had what looks like to be a heart attack on July 20th, 1926, after he gave a fiery speech at a plenum, that's well known. Anyway, so Yevdokimov produces this kind of story about industrial sabotage, and Stalin says, "You know, I need you to tell me more and send it to me directly." So Yevdokimov goes back, and the whole thing fizzles, because nobody will confess. And it's a bust. He's got nothing. And he's sitting there with his minions, all of whom are these counterinsurgents, you know, shoot on sight, police operatives. And one of the persons in economic sabotage, they don't use the word yet, in economic crimes, Zolta, he says, "You know, there's this other group of people, and I think they may be saboteurs." And you know, Yevdokimov, "Really? What do you got?" And so then it turns out that the first one fizzles, and the second one, people begin under torture to testify that, yes, they are saboteurs. So this is almost simultaneous with Stalin going to Siberia. And he comes back from Siberia, and Andreev, who is the party boss in the North Caucasus and a Stalin minion, refuses to do this thing himself. So Yevdokimov goes directly to see Stalin in Moscow. Even the Stalinists know that this thing is all cooked up and fake. Yagoda also knows that this is cooked up and fake, right? They all know it's cooked up and fake. But Stalin begins to see that, well, you know, were the mines flooded? They were flooded. And they said, "Well, they're flooded because we don't have enough personnel for all the mines, and we had to do triage, and so we flooded some of them to focus on the other ones." "Did you flood the mines?" "We flooded the mines." "Did you have contact with the former owners of these mines?" "Well, yeah, it was regime policy to have contact because there were negotiations to lease the former mines potentially. So of course we conducted, we had contact. "You had contact with the former mine owners?" "I see." And on it goes like this, where there's some fact which has an explanation, often a regime order behind it, which now gets twisted into a sabotage story, and you saw those documents being brought into the courthouse, right? The Shakti trial documents. So Yevdokimov does this trial, Shakti. It's the second trial that Stalin's done that he's been involved in that was like this. He did one in Tsaritsyn in 1918, which is also pretty well documented, where he was the dictator of Tsaritsyn on the Volga River, which will become Stalingrad. And he's losing the city, and the whites have it surrounded. And he invents a conspiracy, and he rounds up a bunch of people, and he announces in a newspaper he's created a few days before that there's been a conspiracy, a fifth column style thing, and that he put it down, and they were all executed. Right, so the technology, the fifth column technology, he's already had a version of this in 1918 in Tsaritsyn. Now we're going to see Yevdokimov. I got a better picture in the book. That's the Petropavlovsk going down in the Russo-Japanese War. That's how the book starts. That's the Tsar, as you know, receiving the Duma, the opening of the first parliament. That's Pyotr Durgovol, the policeman, who saves the Tsarist regime in 1906 when he shouldn't have saved it, because then the attacks. That's Stolypin, very shortly before he's going to be murdered in Kiev. That was the Kiev Opera House. Stolypin was going to be murdered. That's, of course, Wilhelm with his withered left arm, just like Stalin, the warlord of Imperial Germany.
That's obviously Stalin's birthhouse. That's the first known picture of Stalin. You can see the attitude. That's that observatory where he was the meteorologist. He had a legal job. That's the Kutaisi prison in 1903. That's the guy that Montefiore has made. That's the Baku prison, which had 8 windows. That's 1910. This is the trial of Kamenev. In the middle, you see Stalin with the hat. There's Sverdlov out in Siberia. That's Kureka, very famous picture from the architecture style. That's Kerensky, obviously. The next one will be Lenin. But I'm going to quiz you on one. Let's see if you know who it is. Famous shot of Lenin, tells you he's a suit. Who's that?
Kornilov.
Yes, that's Lavra Kornilov. Close, but no cigar. What's that? That's the Kornilov putsch. That's the fraternization. What's that? That's Lenin finally made an appearance at the Congress of Soviets. That's Martov, who's just walked out of the room. Rasvalko, as Strauss says, right? That's the first picture of the Sovnarkom, of the government, but this is not the original. That's later because the left SRs were in that picture. That, of course, is Spiridonova. She had Lenin by the you-know-what and let him go. That's the retouched first official regime portrait of Stalin in Tsaritsa. This is Stalin's private photo book. This is the picture that they never published of Stalin and Lenin at Gorky. You can see the Napoleonic pose. That one, I said, is right before they throw the testament in his face, the so-called testament. That's the famous next-to-last picture of Lenin taken by his sister Maria Ulyanova. That's the from the newsreel, a shot of Stalin and Molotov with the Lenin casket, the desk that we already talked about. That's that square, so we've gone to the circle. So we have the Shakti political mobilization. It's a massive political mobilization. Drown out other voices, mobilize the workers to defend the regime against saboteurs, no matter what. And if it's a foreign enemy, if it's an emigre, if it's a kulak, if it's a party official who pretends to be loyal but is actually doing the work of a kulak, then you have to take that person by the throat as well. So this mechanism of political mobilization for the regime that Yevdokimov has produced to Stalin at the Dacha, the first version failed, the second version Stalin is able to go through, and then Yagoda and the rest of them have to come on board. Because if you say that you don't believe they're saboteurs, it could have been you that facilitated the work that they did. Once the accusation of sabotage is there, anybody who begins to fight against the fabrication potentially could implicate themselves de facto, right, ipso facto, because then the spotlight comes on you. Oh, really, you're in charge of the police and you didn't know about this and now you're saying it didn't really happen? Maybe you did. Maybe you're the one who's coordinating all of this. So they all get on board this fabrication, and we have letters. Tomsky's in favor of Shakti, Barashilov is against. Orjonikides is against Shakti. Bukharin, as we know, favored Shakti. Whether for tactical reasons, that's the argument that's been made in the Bukharin case, that he refused to allow Stalin to put him in the opposition. He was trying to not become another Zinoviev and Kamenev. But of course, in the 1920s, during the Civil War period, late teens, early 20s, Bukharin is one of the leading figures in talking about the old regime specialists being saboteurs. So it's hard to know whether he's tactical or not. But anyway, so this is the story that brings you to 1928. That's why the book ends in 28, because the decision has been rendered and the techniques are being invented during the course of 28 with the Shakti trial. And so this guy that's come from the periphery of an empire that's difficult to manage, that's performing more or less well in the international system, but has this crazy czarist autocracy that undermines the state, and then gets involved in the Anglo-German antagonism, and the whole world comes crashing down, and these people get into power in the capital, and they have this Dada-esque 1918 year with no state.
but then they began to build the state, a counterinsurgency state, by confiscation. That's confiscation of everything inside this counterinsurgency state, which is going to last. Stalin gets appointed General Secretary. Lenin, almost immediately, 6.5 weeks thereafter, has the stroke. Then Stalin gets thrown in his face with this testament while he's creating the personal dictatorship. The regime mismanages the quasi-nep concession and doesn't know how to regulate a quasi-market economy. The international situation is threatening because the regime has aligned itself against the entire international system and claimed to be an alternative world order. And Stalin himself, every night they're talking about this in Voroshilov's apartment, and Orger Nikitin with the one kidney doesn't go to Siberia. Stalin goes to Siberia, and Zagumyonny, the naive that he was, contradicts Stalin at the meeting, which provokes a statement that he's going to collectivize agriculture, and it's going to happen starting now, right? And then the Shakti trial, the Yevdokimov being the counterinsurgency master from the North Caucasus, who's got access to Stalin at the dacha. Almost nobody has that access to Stalin at the dacha, right? This is the story of Volume 1. Thank you.
Is that enough for you? I can't wait for Volume 2, where we go to Philistine grandeur. The floor is open. You can help us.
Steve, thank you for breathtaking talk. I wonder about every time that produces its biography of Stalin. So I was reminded of Putin a number of times.
Yes.
And I wonder if that's accidental or not. And you mentioned realpolitik, unsentimental great power, but you also mentioned horses that are named after Murat.
Yes.
So if you took more of Murat into the story, sort of more Platonov into the story, would it be something different?
Yes, I left out the part about how Stalin is, where he acquires the Marxism, the nature of his Marxism, and the type of debates he has, Marxist-like debates, inside the regime with various different people. That shouldn't have been left out, but that was an entire chapter called Faithful Pupil, about him being a faithful pupil of Lenin, him reading Lenin's works constantly, him reading Marx's works constantly. And you will see the vocabulary that they use in the documentation internal to themselves, not the vocabulary only for public consumption, but they were, no doubt, Marxists in their own mind, and they used that vocabulary. Later on, you'll see Stalin talking about finance capital, where he's talking about the Nazis, for example. He uses vocabulary like finance capital. Realpolitikers don't do that. They just don't. They don't talk about the Nazi regime in terms of finance capital. And so the international system is realpolitik. It's brutal and unsentimental, but the regime is a Marxist regime. Now, a Marxist regime, by Stalin's understanding, which, you know, he's constantly going over what Lenin taught in foreign affairs, reminding others about what Lenin wrote, reminding himself. And for Stalin, this means that all means are possible, are fine, in the struggle to defend the socialist revolution. Right? Meaning, nothing is immoral or amoral. Absolutely everything is available. In fact, it's my duty to do whatever is necessary. I need to lie, I'll lie. I need to institute a coup in Germany or Estonia or Bulgaria, the three failed coups that they tried, there are a whole bunch of other coups that they don't try, but that they were plotting, right? So this is clearly what you're suggesting. It's clearly a self-conceived Marxist regime. Moreover, they spent a tremendous amount of time and resources talking about Marxist problematics. They convene Central Committee plenums that are, in some cases, about ideology, but in other cases, get sidetracked into a discussion about ideology. Right? They'll talk about, for example, whether imperialism is the last stage of capitalism or not. And then they'll have an extended debate about this. there'll be a big debate about prices and regulating prices. Mm-hmm. And inside the debate about prices, three quarters of the vocabulary is bourgeoisie, international bourgeoisie, exploiters and bloodsuckers, right? That's their worldview, that's their vocabulary. It's not a means to an end. It's not a symbolic language. It's not signaling or anything like that. It is how they think. It is a worldview, and it's a series of practices, right? And so it's very important to establish this. Bob Tucker did a great job on this with Lotto Cancelli, Stalin's first mentor in the revolutionary movement. This is a well-known story. I have a slimmed down version of it in this book also. But then we see Stalin's invention of Leninism and the reception. What I've got from the sources that have come out more recently is the reception of Stalin's invention of Leninism. Right? Stalin will give the speech at the funeral. Everybody gives a speech. Bukharin doesn't publish the speeches because Stalin's speech is kind of quasi-religious speech. And then Stalin forces Pravda to publish the speech in full a few days later. Right? And so this part of the regime is very, very important. It's their lifeblood. And they have no way to get outside of this vocabulary. And so I have a debate. Sokolnikov is trying to figure this out, right? Sokolnikov, Gersh Brilliant, Garya Sokolnikov, who's going to have a tragic death as an invented Trotskyite in Volume 2. But in Volume 1 has this glorious role to play as the minister, the commissar of finance under the net. And the finance commissariat, like the agricultural commissariat, they're the two biggest commissariats. Ilinka number 9 is the finance commissariat, so it's on the walk of Stalin going back to Old Square. It's in an old bank that's been expropriated from the period. And Old Square number 8 is the agricultural commissariat next to Old Square number 4. I didn't show you, but I have a picture in the book of Old Square number 8. And so you have this entire regime is implanted in bourgeois merchant Moscow. Old Square number 4, Old Square number 8, Ilinka number 9, except for the Kremlin, which is medieval, all of their buildings are in the Kitai border, are in bourgeois. And Lubyanka number 2, Bolshaya Lubyanka, which the Cheka takes over in 1920, not in 1918 when they moved. They're in Lubyanka number 13 at the very beginning, Brzezinski's first office is in a different building, right? All this stuff is Kitai border, all this is the merchant class, and yet, the entire vocabulary of Kitai border merchant, old merchant Moscow is this Marxist vocabulary. And they have this quasi-market economy. So all of that is the stuff of the regime, so you're absolutely right. But here's the thing. It's not necessarily motivating of all the actions. It's the way they think about it, the way they discuss it. But why any individual action is taken or not taken cannot always be derived from specific ideological tenets. Because one of the tenets of Leninism is that if you need to violate the ideology on behalf of the ideology, you should do so. So it's Leninism to be anti-Marxist in many situations. Absolutely. And so this is not a problem for them. They then have a theoretical discussion about how to present it in Marxist terms. But it's not a problem to violate Marxism on behalf of Marxism. Lenin was always tactical that way. And one of the things about Trotsky is a lack of tactical flexibility, right? Whereas Stalin has the more Leninist tactical flexibility, anything goes, including in the name of Marxism and violence. Does that answer the question? Trotsky is a very big figure in this book, by the way, which I didn't talk about also. There's a lot of Trotsky in this book because he's obviously the most important person in Stalin's life, and he begins to become the most important person inside Stalin's head, and then Stalin will project that out and make him the most important person. Did I get it or no? Was that the question or no? I didn't, huh?
You actually answered my question because I was struck in your discussion, you mentioned geopolitics and economy, but that the word ideology did not fall even in the discussion with politicization. So, in a way, that was answered. I have a second.
Well, in the discussion of collectivization, if I may, yeah. It makes the speech about how we can't have large scale and mechanization in a kulak process. We can't be like America. We have to do it in a socialist fashion. Meaning we have to de-kulakize and get rid of private household farms. That's an explicit statement he makes in that January 20th, 1928 speech in Nova Siberia. I did allude to that part, but you're right. There wasn't enough ideology in the rest of the presentation. I stand corrected.
No, that wasn't the aim of the question. You mentioned, however, that he said you don't use enough class. And you also just now said that basically the language was all caught in this Marxist terms. However, that does not necessarily actually mean that they were working towards a Marxist end goal. Would you say that Stalin's end goal was, in the end, the creation of communism, or did that sort of shift after a while into something else, get taken over by his tactical concerns?
Yeah, so there's no documentation at all from inside the regime which is positive towards capitalism. The Communist Manifesto, right, as you know, is a peon to capitalism and the wealth it creates. It's even more peon to capitalism, peon, than Adam Smith is. Right? It's just this encomium about the power, the radical power of the bourgeoisie and capitalism and the market to create the wealth. Then it becomes a fetish. And then, of course, it has to be transcended, aufhebung, it has to be transcended in order to get to the next stage of civilization. Right? So if you look inside the regime when they talk about this kind of stuff, does anybody make a statement about how we were wrong and you don't have to transcend capitalism? Does anybody make a statement about how private property is acceptable in the long term rather than a concession in the short term? Can you point to any internal regime documentation that accepts the market permanently as a part of the regime if they're inside the regime, not if they're bourgeois specialists working in the Commissariat of Finance? Sokolnikov is surrounded by pro-market people because they're the only ones who understand a banking system. And in fact, they're the ones who help him do the monetary reform that stabilizes the NEP and makes the NEP possible. But if you look at the Bolshevik discussions, if you look at the Central Committee documentation, if you look at the stuff that they debated, find me a pro-market, pro-capitalist, pro-bourgeoisie long-term statement by anybody. Now, there's a debate. And the debate is primarily Rykov and Stalin. Rykov is a fantastic figure, an unbelievably strong person. And he's living in the same building as Stalin. And he's got tremendous power and a large following. And Stalin defers to him on economic matters, giving Rykov colossal reign over a lot of stuff. It's not until the end of 1930 that Molotov replaces Rykov as the head of the government. Now, there's a debate, and Rykov is saying not that markets are good, not that capitalism is good, not that private property is good, but he's saying you're an idiot if you think this is going to succeed, collectivization by coercion. You're going to destabilize everything we've achieved with the NEP, and you're going to end up with chaos and nothing. So Rykov is correct. Collectivization is going to produce the catastrophe that Rykov has predicted. And that's where volume two is going to stop, with Rykov's correct prediction of the catastrophe that Stalin is imposing on the country. So Rykov is not pro-capitalist. He's not pro-market. He's anti-destabilization, and therefore he's anti-coercive collectivization. Because he doesn't think, and he's right, that you can do this easily without dire consequences. And Stalin brushes him off. And has this tactical retreat saying, okay, we'll reduce the coercive measures, we'll remove the coercive measures. And then, of course, there's this episode where Bukharin meets with Kamenev in Kamenev's Kremlin apartment on July 11th, 1928. This is also a Stalin provocation, it looks like. Sokolnikov is involved in this, right? So Stalin is using his provocations to push against the tactical retreats against Rykov's argument, don't destabilize the situation. But there is no argument, embrace capitalism, give up the anti-capitalism, give up the anti-market, give up the anti-private property. Because that's exploitation, that's wage slavery. And that's chaos and business cycles, as we call them, or depressions, as they call them, right? And Sokolnikov is the only one. Sokolnikov in the Ministry of Finance, in the Commissariat of Finance, he's the only one who begins to say, we might be able to have a permanent market in the countryside, even though we have socialist industry in the city. He doesn't think it all the way through. He also doesn't have a large following. Also, Rykov can't stand Sokolnikov, unfortunately. But Sokolnikov's ability to admit, right, these guys, this is the problem, you know, I'm an alcoholic, but I can't admit, right? The quasi-market nepting isn't working. The coercion is potentially destabilizing, like Rykov says. Why not just allow the market to be legal and just say, okay, we'll hold the dictatorship, we'll hold the centralized power, we'll do a Chinese style, not there yet, but coming, Leninist market. Why not do that? Why not be Deng Xiaoping? Why not just say that, you know, this Marxism in the economy, let's fudge that, let's let that go. But we'll hold the centralized power, we'll keep the nomenclatura, list system, which the Chinese still have to this day. Right? But nobody in the regime says this. Sokolnikov goes a little bit this way and says, maybe, I don't know, but maybe in the countryside, we might be able to accept the monarchs. On the long term, not just in a concession, because we don't have the power to coercively collectivize them right now. And this is a moment in time. Sokolnikov is briefly in the opposition. Stalin calls Sokolnikov on the phone and says, don't make that speech. Don't make that speech. Please don't make that speech. And Sokolnikov is the SOB. He's a principled person. He makes the speech. It has two parts, one about this, and the other part is how Stalin, the general secretary, should be in an administrative position and not be in the Politburo. And he makes a speech against Stalin's power, famous speech. And Stalin reluctantly removes Sokolnikov from the commissariat of finance. This hurts the net, because then the easy money starts flowing and inflation takes off. So the removal of Sokolnikov is detrimental. Stalin allows Sokolnikov to come back to the Central Committee, even though he's been in the opposition and made the speech of removing Stalin at the Party Congress. It's amazing how far Stalin will go with Sokolnikov for a really long time here. But Sokolnikov, it doesn't have the power to go up against Stalin and his gangster regime, and Rykov and Sokolnikov don't get along, and Rykov never recognizes the market as a long-term acceptable position for a communist regime. So yeah, this is a communist regime. These are communists. They are anti-capitalists, and they're going all the way. They just don't know how to get there, but Stalin thinks he can get there.
But what about the Rykov point? He actually insists that Stalin stay, even though he knows that the policies are going to be.
Yeah, you tell me, you explain that to me. Okay? You explain that to me. Rykov is no fool. He's finally gotten to learn Stalin's personality, right? He's got a lot of contact with Stalin, not as much as you would think, because Rykov is in the Imperial Senate, right? Catherine the Great's Imperial Senate, where Lenin had his office. That's where Rykov's office is, and Stalin's office is on Old Square. And Stalin doesn't use the office he has in the Imperial Senate yet. He almost never uses that office. The Kremlin logbooks for the 20s are about Stalin's Old Square office, not the Kremlin office. But anyway, Rykov is inexplicable to me, because if I were Rykov, I would see this guy is pathological. There are sociopathic behaviors that Stalin is engaging in already in 1927 that have to be visible to Rykov. I put them out in the book. Right? But Rykov, for whatever reason, and you explain it if you can, doesn't feel that he can take Stalin down. You know, it's a little bit like Dmitry Medvedev was president and Putin was prime minister, and Medvedev's people, and I was involved in some of these conversations with the people around Medvedev, were telling him, take him down. You have the power on paper to remove the prime minister as president. And Medvedev thought about it, and he thought about it, and he never did it in the end. And he didn't do it for whatever reason, and we'll never know. Because he'll never tell the truth about it. Strusil, as Piotr Alder told me, private meeting, right? Strusil, he just didn't have the courage. But to take somebody like that down, you can't just remove them formally from the position. Right, this is a gangster, this is a mafia. You've got to destroy the whole thing, the physical person and the entourage. And so it's a pretty big deal. Also, let's remember what Stalin is doing. He's got the whole damn regime on his back. He's working 18, 20-hour days. He's running foreign policy in this brutal, unsentimental international system. He's running the party, right, which is, what, 700,000 members by now? It's no small thing, right? He's organized all the meetings, they're all happening, and they're all on time, and all the people are being told what to do and follow up, should they do it or not. He's running the secret police, right? He's imprisoning people, in some cases, who should be in prison, as well as other people, right? So Rykov knows that Stalin has got this thing on his back. And not Rykov, but other people in the regime are talking about this, and they say, well, what are we going to do? I mean, Trotsky actually talked about this. This is well known for years now. I mean, if not Stalin, then they have Kaganovich, then they have Voroshilov, right? There's all these pygmies around Stalin. And so we don't have any documentation about Rykov's thinking on this question, but you can imagine that he could perceive Stalin's ability to carry all this on his back and Stalin's minions not being up to the task. So managing Stalin may look to him like the smarter approach than trying to destroy Stalin, because you can't destroy Stalin, and if you do, you may not be able to manage without
it. They might actually feel that they need him.
I you know, we don't have the documentation, I don't speculate.
Susan Smith-Peter?
Yeah. Great presentation, really interesting. And I mean, what seems to be coming out of it is that you're arguing that they couldn't get rid of him because Stalin was just such a fantastic bureaucrat. He was just doing the job. I mean, the job was
it's a very hard job.
Yeah. What else? I mean, wasn't that just it?
Well, you know, I mean, you see this at many institutions, right? I mean, I won't refer to the president of NYU. But there's a president of NYU and there's a board, and it's very difficult to manage. You know what it's like to manage a liberal faculty who are independent contractors using the brand name of the university and have a collective veto over all your personnel decisions? You know what it's like to manage something like that? Right? Not everybody can manage that. And so when you can manage something like this, of course there is something to that, but once again, we have no Rykov documentation. But remember, Stalin is a screw-up. He's screwing up left and right. He doesn't understand anything about fascism. And he's got the social fascism argument that the social democrats are more dangerous than the fascists. And he's got this already from the 20s. He's doing these coups, he's instigating these ridiculous coups in places like Estonia and Germany. Germany is the single most important foreign partner. He's got a secret military deal with Germany. He's instigating, he and Zinoviev are instigating this coup in Germany in October 1922. So Stalin is a screw up. He's screwing up a lot of things. He doesn't understand. His blinkers, his ideology, his worldview is incapable of understanding the world as it is. Because he doesn't take the world as it is. He thinks he does, but he doesn't. So we don't want to paint him to be some kind of genius. Right? If you need somebody, right, to run a dictatorship and to invent conspiracies Machiavelli style and put the conspiracies down, so he's your guy. Right? Within a certain context, he's got tremendous skills. But we want to be careful about the way we appraise those skills. Certainly not in moral terms, but also not across the spectrum of management issues, even for a communist dictatorship. He's very ineffective.
But the other people were even more of a mess up.
Well, he's appointed people in some cases because they are well below him. We see that all the time in management, right? All the time in management. You get somebody good, you introduce to the Princeton faculty somebody's really good, and they vote no, because they're threatened by the person who's smart. And then they bring some mediocrity, and they vote unanimous. And that person won't threaten them if they join the faculty, right? So Stalin is bringing all sorts of mediocrities to the top because they're loyal to him. Okay, so there's some of that, and therefore Rykov is looking at that too. But it's still, you know, if Rykov didn't have the killer instinct, that's one other way to put it. But he's really tough. He's tough against Trotsky. My God, Rykov is tougher against Trotsky than Stalin. And Stalin is using Rykov and Bukharin's toughness against Trotsky to make himself look more moderate in a manipulation. Right, so Rykov is no softy, but it's got to be some combination of either miscalculation or calculation that Stalin was an effective figure in the time and that he could be managed. Mm-hmm. Kamenev goes through this too. Kamenev had a chance to take Stalin down twice, as I show in the book. And both times he said no.
Okay, well, thanks for a fascinating lecture, and thanks for bringing up my favorite analogy, which is if you want to explain university governance, look at the Soviet Union.
It's an occupational hazard for us Russians, right?
But let's pursue this question about the exceptional, what we have to explain, the behavior of the people around Stalin, or himself. I sense a tension in the talk between some kind of standard of normalcy that we're expected to have to be when we try to think about the behavior of these people, and on the other hand, a sense that there is a framework in which they're acting that explains it. Now, I want to ask you about who's crazy. You used the word crazy a couple of times in the talk.
And I wasn't speaking about myself. That was an error.
Okay, you used it about what Stalin was like in the first part, and then you used the word crazy autocracy.
Yes.
Now, I think the explanation for Rick's behavior, I think the explanation for the fake resignation, makes us go back and see the normalcy of that autocratic way of rule.
Yeah.
And that it's not an accident these pictures show us Nicholas II and so on. And that we're really seeing is a very long-term some political culture of the leadership of this great unwieldy place where the person who is the autocrat can resign and we won't let him resign.
Yeah.
Where two lines of command are the most normal kind.
Okay, so there's a lot in the book about whether this is the Tsarist regime redux or not. That argument is taken on, and there's discussion about how the chancellery worked in the Tsarist regime and how the secretariat worked under Stalin, so I'm aware of these kinds of questions. But I'm not a political culture analyst. I'm a historical contingency, opportunism sees the moment, agency structure person. And so I don't understand the mechanisms of political culture. I understand the broad statement about political culture and how things look analogous or things look similar. But I don't understand the mechanism of transmission. And so this is just a personal statement, so I don't do a political culture argument. Now, are there things that look very similar in the Soviet regime and the Tsarist regime? Yes, obviously, and you know just as well or better than I do. Are there moments when they discuss these things explicitly? A few, but some, they discuss explicitly about how the Tsarist regime did something, right? So Vita, he wrote his instructions in blue pencil on the documents he received. And Stalin does that. Now, is that something political culture, or is that just the fact that the documents are swamping and overwhelming him, and if you don't write your instructions right there in the documentation, you forget when you do an immediate response, and so Vita and Stalin are similar. I regard that as isomorphism, similar forms arising out of similar circumstances, not a political culture where they're prone to this because of the type of culture that they're in. That doesn't say that the Tsarist institutions don't have an afterlife in the Soviet regime. There's personnel continuities, not in the Commissariat of Foreign Affairs, there's almost zero continuity there. But in the Commissariat of Finance, there's a larger continuity. In some other commissariats, it's more mixed, right? The police have almost zero continuity. The cryptographers end up working for the foreigners. There's only one cryptanalysis analyst from the Okhranka that goes into the Soviet regime that's documented, right? So this is a mixed picture, but the basic answer to this story is that, yes, there is a logic of Tsarism and it's self-defeating. And there is a logic to Bolshevism, and it's self-defeating. But is this because of something inherent in Russia forever? You know, Stefan Hedlund begin with Kiev and Rus and go to Putin, and it's continuous, right? Or is there some other explanation where they could have been on this path, and then they got jerked back onto the other path, not necessarily intentionally? The main difference between the Soviet regime and the Tsarist regime is the Soviet regime is not afraid of modernity. It's not afraid of students. It's not afraid of education, right? It's not afraid of mobilization, mass mobilization in the streets. It's not afraid of mass organizations, right? Union of Russian people, 350,000 Union of Russian people, as you know, 1906, 1907, including village-affiliated branches of the Union of Russian people. Right? This is the right-wing, far-right, mass mobilization
product of the 1905-1906 revolutionary conjunction, significantly bigger than anybody on the left, the Union of Russian People, and reaching into the villages with the leftists are nowhere near any villages at this point. But the Tsarist autocracy refuses to accept street mobilization on its behalf. It is archaic on purpose. They will have the icons and walk through the streets with the icons, but they have the protocols of the Elders of Zion, and they won't do it. They won't do mass mobilization on behalf of them. The Soviet regime is constantly trying and succeeding under Stalin with mass mobilization on behalf. So you have a mass base. The Soviet regime has a mass base, and the Tsarist regime never has a mass base, and that's on purpose. That's definitely on purpose. So the discontinuities are vast. Citizenship under the Tsarist regime is for real. They're trying to get an inclusive citizenship. Under the Soviet regime, citizenship is complicity in mobilization. It's not about rights. It's not about you being part of the polity. It's about you being a cog in the wheel. Now, we can argue about the fine points of this, and I'm making gross statements that need to be refined, you know, in the qualification paragraphs that begin with the word "to be sure." Right? But the differences between the Soviet and Tsarist regime are very, very big, in my mind, even though the continuities like the chancellery operation and the secretariat operation have an isomorphous like similarity. I don't know if I answered that question.
You did. You're telling us that the differences in conceptions of power.
Right? Oh, yeah. There's no question. This is a modern regime on purpose, and the Tsarist autocracy is an archaic regime on purpose with a modern state. It's a fatal flaw in the Russian system. If Dornovo hadn't saved the Tsarist regime in 1906, we would have been in a better spot, a much better spot. You know, you have a liberal constitutional revolution across the world, 1906 to 1911. You got Iran, you got Mexico, and you got China, you got Russia. Where does it succeed? Where does the liberal constitutional revolution succeed in the 1906-11? Nowhere, because you got mass politics now, and it's too late for constitutionalism. It's too late.
Stephen Cohen.
Is that fine? Is that fine?
Yes.
We called on you.
So Wiley was right. It's a really good story. Okay. And you really tell it well. And I think, based only on telling anywhere new, you know, but I would guess that probably 85% of what you say is actually true. So it's great.
You going to give me that much? Is this being recorded?
The 2%, or the other percent, whatever it is, that I've actually done archive work on lately, is something that we should not discuss here. I'll just mention it. And maybe in a correspondence we could share with you. One is about the testimony, of course. Your rendering of how the document doesn't exist, we know that it couldn't write, means that we need the oral accounts in every one of them, Ulyanova's memoirs, for example, where she actually tries to erase it, to save herself, that the document existed. Now, the document, it was oral, it was written down in note forms. And there were two parts, as you said. The other thing that I've spent some time looking about is Rikov. You're absolutely right that he was a much more important figure than he's written in history. It's good, you're going to bring him to the fore. But I think you have him wrong. But that's never right. But let me ask you a question that would be useful for undergraduate teaching. You remember that article Tucker wrote, Several Stalins?
Yeah.
And he had Deutscher Stalin and Carr Stalin.
Yeah, sure.
And then he, of course, added Tucker Stalin. So what's the takeaway on Kotkin's Stalin? Now, I was thinking, just asking myself, if you, and I'm not asking you to critique Tucker's Stalin, but to add Kotkin's Stalin, I took two things away. A guy who really knew how to seize the moment for his own advantage. That's your Stalin, I think. And a guy, what did you call him? Is it crazy?
Sociopath?
Yeah, sociopath, which then puts you sort of into the Tucker Stalin, but in a different way. But in your own words, if you had to say, and maybe it's not fair because you've got one more volume to write and a lot more thinking to do. And we don't have a war and COVID. Yeah. But what if you did this, Kotkin, Stalin, and you're going to teach it to students and you're going to say, because what was useful about that essay is you could have students read and say, which Stalin is correct? What's your Stalin?
So I'm going to let readers answer that question. What I don't do is I don't go beyond the documentation. In other words, if I think something is there, and I'm going to intuit it, but I can't have a quote with somebody expressing this, then I let it go. I don't psychologize, and I don't interpret beyond the documentation that's available. Now, the reader can do that. The reader can read the account, and the reader can say, oh, this means language. I also try not to have a one-account document. It's very rare that I'll allow something which is only in one account or one document to be in the book. I do that on a few occasions where I think it probably did happen. Right, so I'm trying to be cautious and not over, I'm not inserting, I'm not extrapolating, I'm not inventing, I'm not fantasizing. And so I don't always make statements. There's sociopathic behavior. Instead of saying that, I'll demonstrate that. I'll have several paragraphs of things that happen, and then the reader can think, oh my God, this is sociopathic. Right? But I don't go out necessarily with a chapter calling the sociopathic stuff. So how people are going to read him, I got a feeling that there's going to be several Stalins among the readers of this particular book. Now, that's not to say, by the way, have we pre-ordered yet? I don't know, 2 hours. Take your phones out, please, I need to. No, I mean, Tucker Stalin is significantly less documentation than a person like myself enjoys right now, which is no fault of Tucker. So it's kind of silly for me to get up and say, oh, Tucker doesn't do this, or this is bad about Tucker, or you know, I do better than Tucker on this and that. If Tucker were alive today and had these same documents, right, who knows what he could have done. Now, at the time, he used Karen Warning and a few others, right, to try to make up for the fact that through no fault of his own, the documentation was insufficient to do all the stuff he had the ambition to do. But nonetheless, he went for it. He didn't say, oh, we can't really do Stalin because the documents are under lock and key. He went for it, and he used the documents that he could have, which became more and more as time went on, as he proceeded. But he has the Karen Horney substitute for some of the documentation, which is a reasonable research and analytical strategy, but I don't adopt a strategy like that. I have much more ample documentation, and when I run out of documentation, that's it. I stop at that point. So, for example, I could go through, you know, Stalin's relationship to his wife. I think I have a sense of that. But I got no documentation, so the book doesn't go into depth of my analysis of Stalin's relationship to his wife. I give a couple of the anecdotes that are verifiable, and the reader can then look at that and try and decipher it the same way I'm trying to decipher. So that, to me, that looks like a more modest approach to defining Stalin than is usually taken. You know, people, they'll take one little document and then they'll run with it. He's a realpolitiker, he's a Soviet, you know, whatever Stalin wants. He's good or he's bad, right? These kinds of things. So I believe the showing, right? The showing rather than the telling is really important. And I believe the document, it's not a novel. If it were a novel, I could have done a lot. I'm not a good enough writer for that, but I could have done a lot more of the stuff you want. So there is no Kotkin Stalin by design written into the book. But there is a deep and expansive use of primary documentation to convey this regime as a society and him at the center.
And Montefiore's documents are good or no good?
They're the barrier-produced documentation in the 30s. And sometimes I think they could be accurate because there's a second or a third confirmation. And sometimes I think they're just, you know, and he'll quote one passage from a memoir that Barry's minions recorded, and he won't quote the other passage, which contradicts the first passage. He quotes the one that makes for the good Orientalist story.
I'm thinking about the first book, the Red Court of Stalin.
Yeah, you know, so that's a ripoff of Svetlana plus Conquest.
I could have taken, you know, it's any Word document. You can splice it all together. You take conquest on the terror, where Stalin is plotting the terror, you know, as a three-year-old or a five-year-old. And then you take Svetlana's story about how they put the tomato underneath the seat before they sat down, like the merry, knights at the round table. And you put those two together and you get the first Montefiore book. Then you throw all the various stuff in and you get the young Stalin. He's a much better writer than I am. He's a spectacularly good writer and storyteller. But it's a different style. And so I hope there is a Kotkin Stalin. I hope there's a consensus on that. And I'm going to be interested after you pre-order and get your copy to hear what that Stalin is.
You can't leave the room until you do. Do we have time for one more?
Absolutely.
Wonderful. Could you introduce yourself?
John Bowen. Let me ask a big picture question to follow up on Steve Cohen's remarks. The galley proofs just went by me, and even by your own standards, we can say that in terms of documentation, you have over-fulfilled the production lines.
I won't be out-researched.
But that still raises an interesting question, in that there are other materials, at the start of your talk, referring to them, that remain unavailable, offline, whatever. Can you imagine finding something, or do you think there might be anything in those materials that would in any way undermine or change materially the picture of Stalin that you've produced without them?
If it happens, then I will accept that documentation. You know, when I was the chair of the editorial board at Princeton University Press, and we would get these things, people would have an argument, and a new book would come out, and it would explode the previous person's argument. And the previous person would say, I'm going to hold to my interpretation. And you're like, oh my God. And then the physics book would come in, and 100 laboratories around the world have reproduced the experiment that explodes your work. And you try to hold on to that in physics, and there's no way. In fact, you latch on to the destruction of your work, you take the new paradigm, and you try to advance the new paradigm and become the leader in the new paradigm. Right? So I'm going to try and overcome whatever instincts I have and behave the way you're suggesting, which is if the new documentation comes out eventually and this requires revision of the book, I'm going to take that and latch onto it and say, this is better. So let's take one concrete example, and that's the Hitler-Stalin Pact. I wrote the chapter, the Hitler-Stalin Pact, Volume 2, and I read all the original materials, right, the German stuff, the French stuff. And you can read a lot of this in Stalin's documentation, because Stalin has an agent in French and military intelligence, right? And so you can read not only the French version of the French stuff, but the Stalin version of the French stuff. It's very interesting. You can go through, and it's almost all there. But then there are these novels that have quotations of letters from Hitler to Stalin, beyond the ones that were published in Pravda, the few telegrams that are established as real. And so I poked around. You know, the first time I got in the presidential archive, Naumov Starshi was still alive. And Naumov Starshi, the elder Naumov, had an apartment across the street from the old American embassy in that massive, gigantic thing, and was way up on the top. And I would go up there and I would bring him goodies from the US, like I brought him Volsky's Memoir of the Neck, for example, just a photocopy from the Volsky book, published in, the 70s on the network. And he was so grateful, and then in exchange, he would talk to me about the stuff that he was getting in the president, what was then called the Politburo Archive, and became eventually a presidential archive. Yeah, I developed a relationship with him, right? And then he got on the Stalin's archive was for a while in Stalin's office. The old Politburo presidential archive was actually in the Imperial Senate, in the second floor where Stalin had his office. Unfortunately, that's been refurbished now. They've totally redone the interior of the Imperial Senate. But I was in Stalin's office. Actually, it's a suite of offices. It's a very complicated suite of offices. I was in Naumov's office on Ilinka when they moved the presidential archive out to Ilinka. And Naumov Starshi was involved in the Alexander Yakovlev project. So on his desk was all sorts of stuff, and he saw a lot of stuff. I met Volkogonov and talked to Volkogonov, and I constantly pounded them. What do you guys have on the pact that you're not showing? What do you got? What's the secret stuff? Where is it? You know, are there any letters from Hitler to Stalin that we don't know about? Are there jottings from Stalin, this and that? And the answer came back negative from both Naumov and Volgogonov, including when Naumov had had something to drink, and after tremendous flattery of Volgogonov. Right, I was vice dean of the Woodrow Wilson School, and it's all flattery. You need anything, it's just, you flatter. No vocabulary is too shameful. And nothing came out from those conversations. Does that prove that there's nothing there on the pact? No, it does not prove that. But, you know, I tried to go as far as I could to make sure there was nothing there that I was missing that was highly significant. We already have very significant things on the pact that we didn't know before from the military archive that Volgogonov helped produce, which is that the Wehrmacht and the Soviets go to war in September 1939. They have a fight, and there are casualties on both sides over the Drohobych oil fields, right? So there's new stuff on the pact that came out within the last 5-10 years, but we don't have everything for sure 100%. So what should I do? Should I wait forever till that letter from Hitler that's in the novels comes out, which may not exist? No, you go to publication, you know, with the text, but the documents that you have, as Don Rumsfeld, graduate of Princeton University, said. Right, Josh? Yeah. Anyway, so yeah, I wonder if there's other stuff I don't have. You know, on the testament, so there's no shorthand. There's no handwritten testament. There is no taking down the shorthand of Lenin's dictation. There's documentation about Lenin's inability to speak, the fact that he had paralysis of the right hand, couldn't write himself. But that's not only it. It's the absence, there's shorthand documentation for the December 23rd letter that Lenin dictated to Stalin. Which is
included. Which one are you talking about?
About expanding the Central Committee. There's shorthand documentation in Nadia's hand. And Nadia Aleluyeva worked in Lenin's secretariat. That's the last document in her hand in Lenin's archive, right? And so, but then December 24th, 25th, 26th, and on down, there's no shorthand anymore. And the Boloditcheva memoirs and all the stuff that testifies to this production of this Lenin document, they were all done after Stalin dies. Every single one of those memoirs is post-Stalin. The only non-post-Stalin memoir is the Ulyanova memoir, and it comes in different forms. And moreover, she wasn't part of that. She never had her hand on that. She was outside the room. And a lot of times when Stalin went to see Lenin in Gorky, he wasn't admitted inside the room. Krupskaya would ask the question and then shut the door behind her, right? A lot of famous scenes where Lenin is being visited by Stalin and Gorky, only Krupskaya is the intermediary. She's the intermediary for the typescript testament that we have, which has additions from later time, because it's published in the bulletin of the Party Congress in 1927, and that's different from the PSS version, and Lenin's dead now. So there can be no further additions. So how is it going to be different from the 27 version to the 1950s, 58 to 64 version of the PSS, right? This stuff, Valentin Sakharov has a 600-page book on this. And he's gone through very carefully. I discovered the Sakharov book after I started telling people that I was surprised that there was no shorthand of the dictation. And people said, haven't you read Valentin Sakharov? And I said, no, who's he? So now I've read the Sakharov, and I recommend everybody in this room.
Is this about Shanya Lenin?
Yes. And so there's Ostrovsky on the early Stalin. You know, this book is reliant on tremendous secondary sources that have been produced. When I, 15 years ago, I read however many books, 90% were in English and 10% were in Russian secondary sources. Now, when I read, it's 5% in English, 95% in Russian secondary sources. Because I'm not learning anything from the English language books, unfortunately. And I'm learning a tremendous amount from the literature produced in Russia. This guy, Alexander Plekhanov, with the counterintelligence archive in Omsk, his books are unbelievably good. Now, he's a Stalinist. He's a patriot. He's, you know, a pro-regime person. He believes the West is trying to undermine a capitalist encirclement in the 20s. I don't have to believe that, but when he's quoting the counterintelligence documentation, and when the quotes are lining up with stuff that you can find elsewhere too, and verify, it looks pretty good. The testament thing is a little bit tricky, but there's a huge amount of stuff produced in the Russian language now. On the World War II, I'm
finding out stuff in World War II that I never knew before, and it's all coming out of the military archives, and it's all coming out of Russian language monographs that are 1,000 pages long and multi-volume, and that's, I mean, it's killing. So, you know, the amount of research I did on this, I started this 11 years ago. So it took me 11 years to produce volume. Of course, I have been haranguing some of the people in the audience longer than that with these stories, because I've been teaching this in my graduate seminar, my undergraduate lecture, for a really long time. But the exhaustive, comprehensive rereading of the primary sources, that's been these last 11 years, right? Every time I think I get a handle on that, more stuff gets thrown into the public realm. And so I feel obliged to read everything that gets thrown into the public realm. And if more stuff comes in between now and the paperback, John Bone, and I made a mistake, there'll be a discussion in the preface about the mistake that I made and why I'm correcting it in this particular volume. Did that answer your question or no?
Yeah, let me just sort of say for the record that I'm not being critical of
it was a good question.
For not looking at stuff that you can't look at. It's more a matter of if, again, follow up on what Steve Cohen said about the Kotkin Stalin. If we take the essence of the Kotkin Stalin to be that Stalin was highly tactical and extremely complicated, okay.
All right.
Then whatever comes out, we're arguing about the details, not changing the big picture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think there's more to it than that, but you know, I mean, we could go on forever, and I still won't get the full 750 pages of text delivered to you in this venue. Right? There are other dimensions to this question. The nationalities dimension and the fact that he's a Georgian or doesn't want to be a Georgian, right? That's a really big part of the book. And how he understands the Soviet Union and Lenin doesn't. Lenin doesn't know anything about Ukraine. Lenin doesn't know anything about Georgia, right? That's another big part of the Stalin that comes out. There's many other things that I haven't presented, you know, I haven't browbeat you with now, because I was told this goes to 5 o'clock and it's 5:20 something already. And so, you know, I'm already, I've cheated you from 21 minutes of time.
No, we've cheated you. What we should do actually is continue with the reception. I mean, I don't think you're willing to stop anyway.